Satan's final war plan exposed. The devil has a war plan, and we're going to expose it this morning. Now, there's a final war, you know. It's called Armageddon. Millions of men are going together in the Mideast, and there's going to be a final war called the Battle of Armageddon. There's going to be a lot of bloodshed. But simultaneously, there's another final war. And this final war is far more important to us and to God than Armageddon. Armageddon is just a cleanup job for God. He's going to clean up the mess. He's going to come forth with his power and his glory, and we know the outcome of that war. But there's another war going on simultaneously, in effect even now, and that's the spiritual war. This is the war that's been declared, yes, in the Garden of Eden. You say there's always been a spiritual war, heaven against hell. But folks, the devil in these last days is changing his strategy. He's changing his plan. Because the Bible says, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, the devil's come down to you having great wrath, knowing his time is short. Now, see, this is placing this battle, this last strategic battle, after the cross. Because he's talking about those who've overcome by the blood and those who have the testimony of the Lamb. So this is after Calvary, it's after the cross. Dragon was wroth with the woman. The woman is the church of Jesus Christ. And went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. All right, this places the war that we're talking about after the cross, those who have been covered by the blood of Christ. And this leads to the last, very last day of time, the battle that I'm speaking about. The scripture says he knows he has a short time. And the Bible says that he comes down. He's actually going to make his headquarters. He's going to be among us here on this earth. He's come down unto you, and he's in a rage because he knows that his time is very short. This is the last of the last days. I don't know what others are preaching about spiritual warfare. I hear a lot of stuff that is foolishness. And even when you say spiritual warfare, a lot of people pull back. But the Bible makes it clear that there's a war going on in the heavens. There's a spiritual battle now for your mind and your soul. There's a spiritual battle, and the Bible, Paul talks about the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Weapons of war, our war, it says. Our war. The war that you and I fight as the seed of Jesus Christ. He's going after the seed, the scripture says. And this is the battle far more important in the eyes of God and hell than Armageddon itself. The Spirit is going to expose the stratagems of the devil for this last day. I'm just thinking of the strategy the devil has used ever since the Garden of Eden. And Satan came and tempted in these areas of flesh and appetite. And very little of the warfare of Satan against the church of the wilderness was aimed at the leadership. And you find many of these men falling, but at that time, Satan's warfare had to do with appetite. It had to do with the belly. It had to do with nature. But then comes the cross of Jesus Christ. Then comes the need for a new strategy, a new plan. And folks, the devil has, the Bible says, we're not ignorant of the devices or the wiles of the devil. The wiles mean plans, strategies. That very word is strategy. We're not ignorant of his strategy. His strategy keeps changing. And now we come to the cross. We come to the strategy now of Satan coming against entire congregations. He comes against the laity. He comes against the church body. He comes against whole congregations. And it's amazing when you follow it. He attacked the Corinthian church with a flood of lust and carnality. He comes to the Galatian church with a bewitching spirit. Paul said, having begun in the spirit, are you now seeking perfection through the works of the law? Who has bewitched you? Who's cast the spell on you? A new strategy from the enemy. He's going after entire congregations. He's going after the laity. You follow it through in Revelation, first few chapters of Revelation. At Pergamos, false doctrine was sent to leaven the church. At Thyatira, the devil sent teachers in with the Jezebel spirit to seduce the congregations into fornication. And when you come to Sardis, you find formality and deadness cast upon them. and at Laodicea, a spirit of lukewarmness, covetousness, materialism, blinded the whole congregation. You see, he's going after the laity, he's going after the congregation, he's going after the masses of believers. You very find, very seldom do you find in the New Testament him going after or being able to bring down spiritual leadership. Those who are spiritual men, leaders of the Church of Jesus Christ, you find him coming again as he did in the Old Testament, shipwrecks, beatings, jailings. He comes after Paul in the flesh, but you don't see Paul folding under it. You don't hear Peter, and you hear none of the disciples other than Judas. He's not, the battle now is for the church, the laity. He's going after, he's coming stages, you see, works in the natural, that he comes against the congregation. We're going to see in just a moment where he's moving now. That in this last day, in this short period of time, the devil with such wrath knows he has to change his strategy. And the strategy is this: I'm going after the leaders. I'm going to focus all my attention on everyone who has spiritual authority. Everyone who walks close to Christ. Every prayer warrior. I'm going after their very faith. I'm going after their homes, their marriages. I'm going to try to paralyze every spiritual man and woman on the face of the earth. And all that's happening to the Church of Jesus Christ today, as we see this strategy unfolding everywhere we look. Pastors, missionaries, Christian leaders, deacons, elders falling left and right. Spiritual authority being robbed. We see this strategy unfolding before our very eyes. This was the strategy used in Iraq. They were called special forces, and they were sent 6 months before the war into Baghdad. And their whole job, they were dressed as Arabs. And they had a bankroll, and they were to trail Saddam Hussein everywhere he went. One purpose: surround Baghdad, get Saddam, get the leadership. Don't fight with the Iraqi army, go to the elite corps, the Republican Guard, and when we get that Republican Guard and those 50 leaders, they'll fall and they'll collapse. And within 2 weeks of the war, remember, there was confusion in the Iraqi army because they said, there's no leadership, there's no one there. It's inoperative. The authority's gone. Satan's final war against the Church of Christ is targeted at the elect. Paralyze every spiritual leader. Destroy, seduce, bewitch all spiritual authority. And now you see the devil's laid his hands on every invention of man to use in this battle. The devil owns the internet. He owns it. 300,000 porno sites. He owns it. He owns the film industry. I don't even know what the music channel is. I don't have television. But he owns television now. He owns commercial television. He owns network television. Because you see, up to this time they said, we're going to stretch the envelope. That means, see how far we can go without the people rising up, without a moral outcry. Outcry against this filth and smut. And there's no outcry anymore. And now, I read in the New York Times, these were from film directors in the Cannes Festival in France. And they were boasting publicly, we're no longer stretching the envelope. We've torn it up. We're going over the ledge. That means anything goes. And folks, who is all of this? Who's the devil aiming at? Now, do you think he's aiming at all the people who are hooked on pornography now? All of the wicked masses who are hooked on the lust of the flesh? He already owns them. The king of Syria said, I'm not wasting any ammunition, no chariots, no manpower on these masses. All my power, everything is aimed at the leadership. These things are aimed now. Everything out of hell is aimed. Now let me tell you what gives you spiritual authority. Let me tell you what in the eyes of God, in the eyes of the devil, make you marked. In the eyes of God, marked for righteousness and marked for usefulness. In the devil's eye, marked for this final attack. is that you have set your heart on Christ. You seek Him with all your heart and mind and soul and spirit. You've turned from the things of this world, and you have laid a hold of something that you won't let go, and the devil knows it. And you're a testimony of the righteousness of Christ in this dark, wicked age. If you are praying, man or woman, believing, trusting God, living in His righteousness by faith, you are marked. You are in that leadership. You are in that elite guard, not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Why would he waste any? He'd be a stupid devil to waste his ammunition on those he's already killed. Satan understands that secret sin in a spiritual man will paralyze him. All his power and authority will be gone. And if sin is persisted on and becomes habitual, he knows the man can no longer speak for God, can no longer have any impact on anyone living in sin. You see, the devil's plan is to put this fly of death, just a touch of flesh, a touch of the world. Let me tell you what's at stake. And the reason Satan's now focusing all his power on the spiritual man. Paul sets forth the issue, and here it is. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they're foolishness to him. Neither can he know them, because they're spiritually discerned. Paul said, now there's a spiritual man and there's a natural man. The spiritual man knows the mind of Christ. He's full of the Holy Ghost. No part dark, no flies of death in him. He's got spiritual wisdom. He has revelation from God. He has an open heaven. And God reveals his mind to the spiritual man. The scripture says the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Things that no man can know. And God gives it and speaks it through those who are spiritual. Paul said, my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. And I came in the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Now, what is that? Demonstration of the Holy Ghost. We have a lot of people who think the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, people falling on the floor, wiggling, shaking. Now, God can shake you and wiggle you. I believe God can take people and just prostrate them. I'm not mocking that. But that's not what Paul's talking about. The demonstration of the Holy Spirit had nothing to do with Paul's body. It was not raising his voice like I'm raising mine right now, because a loud voice doesn't imply anointing. Sometimes when you get anointed, you can't help it. You just explode. But that does not designate the anointing. See, the demonstration of the Holy Spirit was not some aura or countenance that changed in Paul. He was not doing anything but quietly delivering the Word of God, and there was suddenly a demonstration of the Holy Spirit. It was the Word of God delivered through a spiritual man. You see, the Corinthians had moved out of the spiritual realm into the natural realm. And that's what's happening to the Church of Jesus Christ today. You sit in front of a television and you drink and drink and drink, and I'm telling you, slipping hour by hour into the natural man that can no longer comprehend the things of God, because you lose your discernment. And now Paul said, I'm coming to Corinth to a natural people living in the flesh. They're natural again. They're not spiritual men and women. They're carnal. The carnal man is the natural man. He said, I couldn't even speak to you as spiritual people anymore. Demonstration of the Holy Ghost with power was the effect his preaching had on the hearers, on the people, on the Corinthians. Life change is the demonstration. People walking out of the house of God with a message they can't shake out of their head or out of their heart, and they have to act on it, because the Holy Spirit keeps moving them in the direction of the word they've received. They had drifted from Christ and were compromising. You see, folks, here's the dilemma. Let me put it as simply as I can. You show me a church of 10,000, 25,000 people, masses coming. And those that come to church, if they're not a preaching of repentance, if they're not changing, they're all natural people. They're carnal. They're still living in sin, because there's no message and no conviction and no Holy Ghost moving in the church. And if the man in the pulpit is just a man of ambition, if he too is in the natural and he is in the flesh, then I'm going to tell you that a whole congregation could go to hell, because they've never had a mess. They don't understand. There's nobody there to open their eyes. There's no message from heaven that pierces the wall There's nothing that gets through to the heart. And I'm convinced there's many people are going to hell in the church than anywhere else in society. Going to hell right in church. Because natural men are speaking to natural men and they don't understand. The divorce rate in the church equals the divorce rate in the world now. The divorce rate in the ministry equals the divorce rate in secular society. What a sad comment. Now, what's my point? Satan knows that men seduced back into the realm of the natural can no longer hear or receive a word that can change a life. Comes blinded. It's no message, no anointing, nothing that pierces the heart. And that's why Satan's going after every spiritual elder, deacon, Sunday school teacher, anyone in any kind of ministry, choir, going after with everything out of hell. And I'm telling you, folks, there's never been a time when you have been more tested than you are now. You have never been more tested. Your faith has never been more tried than it is now. Folks, never in history have we needed spiritual people who know the mind of Christ, and they can stand against the world and all of the natural thing that's just destroying mankind, and have that word that penetrates and changes where there's a demonstration of the Holy Ghost. You may not even respond emotionally to what I'm saying, but I hope and pray when you walk out the door, God will have said something to you that'll change your life. Make some changes. Your life has already been changed, but make those changes that are necessary to come into the fullness. If the devil has a plan, what does God have a plan? I want to tell you something. The Lord is not going to come down and fight your battle with the devil. I mean, he's already done that. He's already conquered the devil. He's been victor. He's beyond the reach of Satan. The devil can't tempt him anymore, but he says, now you resist the devil and he will flee from you. Now, God doesn't have to change his plan. He's had one eternal purpose from the beginning, and that's focus on Jesus Christ, and we know that. And it implies that once you come under the government of Jesus Christ and the Spirit of God, who is the Spirit of Christ, when you come under that government, there's to be a continual increase. There has to be an increase. We increase in obedience, in submission, subjection. Are you under the government of the Holy Spirit? This is how I believe God is going to protect his leadership. He's going to protect all of those who are in the spiritual man. He's going to protect you, he's not going to end pornography. Evil men are going to wax worse and worse, the Bible said. Things are going to get so bad that sexual content will be bestial, it'll be incestuous, it'll be with children, it's going to be with animals. It's going to be the most incredible filth and smut the world's ever known. And God's not going to stop that right now until the end. The devil's going to come with his flood. The flood is going to increase. The flood tides are going to get higher. But he's going to build up a spiritual immunity. He's going to do something in the hearts of his people, because the government of Jesus Christ is going to increase more and more. He's going to have a body who are more and more subjected to the Holy Ghost, who cry out for that direction, who submit themselves in prayer and to the Word of God. And they begin to judge their sins righteously. We're to judge righteous judgment. In the last days, when he sees this attack of the enemy, God says, I'm going to rise with a jealousy. And I'm going to accomplish my purpose. And my purpose, as he describes here, I'm going to bring divine order. And I'm going to bring forth a spirit of judgment. Now that is not judgment against us. This has to do with something far different. It's something he's going to do in our hearts, a spirit of judgment against anything that Satan throws against us. In other words, the Holy Ghost is going to make you a magistrate of your own heart. And the word there is litigate. It means everything that comes. And here's what Paul the Apostle said in 1 Corinthians 2:5. He that is spiritual, listen, he that is spiritual judgeth all things. He judges all things. It means that everything that the enemy throws into his life, every temptation, everything he's involved in, every waking hour, he's judging everything that influences or affects his life. He's judging it. He's a magistrate. And the Lord has empowered him by his Spirit to sit as a judge over his own life. He said, if we judge ourselves, we shall not be judged. You know that scripture. Let me put it plainly. If you're flirting with a married person, or another man's wife or another one's husband? That's adultery. Judge it. Call it what it is. It's sin. Call it. Bible says, set no wicked thing before your eyes. You just brought in a video. And you said, oh, it's just PG or PG-13. It's just Walt Disney. And suddenly, here's God's name being cursed. What are you going to do? You just going to justify it? Or are you going to judge it? Will you sit there and allow the Holy Ghost just to stir your heart? He will do it. He will stir your heart. And he'll do it out of love because he says, I need your anointing. I need a voice. I need to penetrate this wicked world. I need you. I'm not mad at you, but I need your voice. And he's going to convict you. You either justify it or you'll judge it and say, this could cost my anointing. That's enough. Judge it. You find yourself slipping into a little bit of gossip, and the Holy Ghost suddenly said, hey, this is wrong. This is wrong. And you agree with the Holy Ghost. Yes, it's wrong. You stop and shut your mouth and walk away. Judge it. You see, David sinned, and he wouldn't judge his sin for a whole year. God didn't break his covenant with David. He didn't break the covenant. He's not going to break his covenant with you. But he said, a prophet. And what the issue was, David, until you agree with the Holy Ghost, until you judge your sin and call it what it is, and not justify. David been justified. And as soon as David stopped justifying his sin, then the promises of the covenant were renewed in his life. And every covenant promise of God awaits the moment that you and I agree with the Holy Ghost and say, this is sin. I'm not going to call it by another name. I'm going to judge it. I can't live in unbelief. Unbelief is the mother of all sins. And you find yourself doubting God and questioning God. Oh, come on, folks. Judge it for what it is. It's sin. We have to judge our sins because he has given us the mind of Christ. We have the mind of Christ in us. We have the Holy Ghost. And I'll tell you, the moment you agree with the Holy Ghost, he comes with every covenant promise. And the Bible makes it clear, this scripture, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall raise up a standard against. And I looked up that word standard, and you know what it really means? A flip of the finger. And the moment you agree with the Holy Spirit, the moment you judge your sin and say, I'm not going to lose my anointing. I'm not going to have a fly in my ointment. I'm not going to let the devil rob me of my effectiveness. And I judge my sin. When that happens, the Holy Ghost comes and flits away the power of hell in your life. Just a flick of his finger. It's done. It's finished. He empowers you with his glorious power. That's the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. The demonstration is judging your sin. The power comes flowing in. Glory be to God. What a mighty God. Lord, you so love your people. You so love your pastors and shepherds and all those in leadership. They're your family. They're bone of your bone and flesh of your flesh. And you will not allow the enemy to destroy. You're going to come forth, Lord, with great governing power. You're going to manifest by your Spirit the law of God written in the heart, bringing us under subjection to your word and your Spirit. And Lord, we're going to be more than overcomers, not just overcomers, but more than overcomers. Hallelujah. Now, Lord, I'm asking for a demonstration of power, demonstration of your Spirit with power to change us. For those that are here now, and while we're speaking, Holy Ghost, you were just pointing out something, perhaps a dead fly, a fly of death, something that the Holy Ghost has been just peacefully, wonderfully, lovingly nagging us about, saying, change it. Make a change before it becomes a habit and you no longer see it as sin. You justify it. Oh, Lord, we want to agree with the Holy Ghost. We call it what it is. If you're here this afternoon or this morning, and something in the message this morning, this something grabbed your heart. I don't know how to put this other than as I feel led by the Holy Spirit that you know that you are not where you ought to be in Christ. Especially if you've been walking with God for a long time. If you've been hearing a lot of messages, you've been hearing the Holy Ghost speak and cry and woo and whisper to your heart, and you keep putting it off and putting it off. It's time. It's time this morning to say yes, Holy Spirit. If there's sin, he's not here to condemn you. He's here to say, I will not lose you. I'm not going to let you go. I'm going to make a little bit of misery in your heart. I'm going to convict you, but I do it because I need you. If you're a husband, you need that spiritual authority and you need his guidance. If you're a wife or if you're a mother and you have children, you need spiritual authority. You're not going to get through your kids without spiritual authority. All the pastors, including myself, we have warned you about your viewing television and the filth and the films that you bring into your home and everything else. In these areas, if that has to be dealt with, agree with it right now. And when you walk the streets, ask God to give you clean eyes. Ask God to help you because the seductions are so overwhelming. And ask God to put you in the habit of listening to the Holy Spirit. It becomes a wonderful habit. The Holy Spirit is so quick, so quick. It's a loving judgment. It's something the Lord says, I do this for you because I so love you. I do this for you because I've done such a miracle in your life, and I want to use you with your neighbors. I want you to be the testimony. Because I want everything that you say to have an impact on those around you. When your neighbors are sick and afflicted, when somebody around you has a problem, they bring it to you. So you're not just mouthing words that fall to the ground, but you're saying things that penetrate the heart. Do you understand that? I come now asking you, Holy Spirit, to demonstrate what we're talking about. Holy Spirit, I want to see, and I don't want to see it, but I want you to demonstrate in the hearts of these, let there be a manifestation of your Holy Spirit that comes right now and just comes and shines the light in and says, yes, I know, Lord, that what I have allowed is sin. And I agree with you, Holy Spirit, it can't go on. It has to stop. And I know, Lord, as I agree with you, you're going to come now with every precious covenant promise. You're going to put a new heart in me on this. You're going to keep me now from falling. You're going to give me a heart after you. Lord Jesus, I thank you for this. Would you say this right now? Lord Jesus, I come humbly to you. And I come, Lord Jesus, to submit to your government. I want you to rule my life by the word and the still small voice of the Spirit. I want to obey you, Lord. Help me. I can't do it in my strength. But I believe that the Holy Ghost came and saved me by opening my heart, and I've repented. So the Spirit of God is in me. Thank you that you'll guide me. You will keep me. We give you thanks.